Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome to 2021, first Sunday in a brand new year. Welcome to everyone out there in the parking lot, online, and of course here in person. Show of hands, who are the New Year's resolution people among us? We have one. We got a sort of maybe. Any New Year's resolution people in the parking lot?
No.
Well, I guess that's okay. I don't know that I'm big into that. But as we gather, as we begin a new year, you know, one of the things that worship is about, not the exclusive thing, but one of the things worship is about is you and I being reminded of some things about who God is and about how God walks with us and his love and grace, mercies in our own life. Because we can go through the course of a week and there can be a lot of things that impact our lives that maybe diminish that message, or we may even lose sight of it. And so we're going to begin this morning with simply a song that will remind us of what we maybe most need to have in our own life as we look forward to, hopefully, a new year, maybe with some more bright spots to it than this past year was, but about God's mercies that are new as we get to start over with a new year. Join in our opening song. you pray with me? Lord, as we turn the page in what is our way of chronicling dates for the new year, Lord, we're hopeful that it is new in more ways than one. It'd be a new beginning, a new start for this planet and all that it's been impacted by in the last 9 or 10 months or more. So Lord, we are in great need of not only your presence, but of your movement in our world, in our lives. And Lord, you can begin there with your mercies that are new every morning. May they be new today in our life. That your view of us is one of grace, not of judgment, life-giving rather than taking life away. Lord, as we gather here and worship online in the parking lot or in person, may your hopeful messages of who you are and who we are in a relationship with you, may those resound over and over again. May they be our source of strength and our refuge. We trust in who you are and what you've done. So Lord, we gather once again in this new year. We gather in your name, the name that rises up above every other name, as we know you as the God who comes as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, all God's people said together. Amen. So in many respects, it has been a hard year. Doubts, trust, all those sorts of things as we look back may have waffled. In the midst of that, we find some truths to stand firm on.
Scared. Oh, I thought I knew I'm scared. But I'm so filled with fear. I can barely move. This is the truth I'm standing on.
To that truth, those truths add this one. The mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ, was given to die for you. And for his sake and by virtue of what he has done for us on the cross, I get to declare to all of us the entire forgiveness of all of our sin. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Great to have you all here. Looks like the weather has cleared a little bit. Good to see that. Thanks again to Molly, and when she's not there, Mom, wherever Mom is. There she is over there. We're appreciative of that. And Hirschberger's and Sam, or no, who's it? Hirschberger's and Pearson's today for helping with our greeting. And if you have some concerns that you'd like to share, we invite you to use those connection cards that you receive and share those prayer concerns with us. And also, if you're a first-time worship guest, we hope that you fill that out and let us know of your presence here with us. We'd love to send you something in the mail. And with that, our good news reading for today from Luke chapter 2.
The good news reading for today comes from the second chapter of the Gospel according to Luke. Now, every year his parents went to Jerusalem for the festival of the Passover. And when he was 12 years old, they went up as usual for the festival. When the festival was ended and they started to return, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem. But his parents did not know it. Assuming that he was in the group of travelers, they went a day's journey. Then they started to look for him among their relatives and friends. When they did not find him, they returned to Jerusalem to search for him. After 3 days, they found him in the temple, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. And all who heard him were amazed at his understanding and his answers. His parents saw him. They were astonished. And his mother said to him, "Child, why have you treated us like this? Look, your father and I have been searching for you in great anxiety." He said to them, "Why were you searching for me? Did you not know that I must be in my father's house?" But they did not understand what he said to them. Then he went down with them and came to Nazareth and was obedient to them. His mother treasured all these things in her heart. And Jesus increased in wisdom and in years and in divine and human favor. Here ends the good news reading.
Grace to you and peace from God our Father, from our Lord and Savior, Jesus, who is the Christ. Amen. The year was 1968 when I was 12 years old. Some of you are a lot closer to 12 years old than I am right now. But I couldn't help but read this story today and think about being 12, think about, you know, was there something really important that happened in my life, worthy of it being maybe written down even, something that was defining? I can't say that I came up with anything all that conclusive. I thought about the fact that, you know, when I was 12, I had a size 12 foot. Because, you know, I had a size whatever my age was. That's just the way it worked for me, unfortunately. I was in the seventh grade. I had to share a bedroom with my brother, Jim, when I was 12. My best friend when I was 12 was a guy by the name of Dwayne Sitkiewicz. He used to sing about him. S-I-T-K-I-E-W-I-T-Z, Sitkiewicz. He didn't appreciate that. Probably still doesn't now. Back when I was 12, I had one of those big balloon, flat, fat, tired bikes with a big basket because I delivered the Chicago Tribune and the Chicago Sun-Times early in the morning, a lot earlier than I get the Lima News these days, unfortunately. That was my first job. When I was 12, I desperately wanted to quit taking piano lessons, but my mother wouldn't let me when I was 12. When I was 12, I learned how to shoot a basketball for the first time the right way, and actually was a part of an organized team in seventh grade. Back when I was 12, Hey Jude came out in 68. It was my favorite song, mostly because it was a slow-moving song by the Beatles, and they played it like 10 times every time there was ever a dance, because it was the only song I would dance to, because it was a slow dance. I didn't do the fast. There was a thing that went on back in 68 called the Vietnam War. I really, as a 12-year-old, didn't pay much attention to it. Didn't even know where Vietnam was, for that matter, when I was 12. When I was 12, living outside of Chicago, there was a big hubbub at some DNC, Democratic National Convention, where there was rioting and protests and all kinds of violence happening right there in the city of Chicago when I was 12. When I was 12, a guy by the name of Martin Luther King Jr. was assassinated. I didn't know too much about him at the age of 12. Didn't know that it mattered all that much for me, but know a little bit more now. When I was 12, I remember watching the Olympics and these two guys that were runners that did really well. One guy won a gold medal, and when they stood on the podium in New Mexico City and they played the national anthem because they had won, these two guys had fists up in the air with black leather gloves on it while the national anthem was playing. I remember as a 12-year-old, I didn't know exactly what that was all about, what that meant. I had my first crush on a girl. We had dances in that multi-purpose room over there at Grove Junior High School. I danced, not fast dance like this. I waited for Hey Jude to come up. My first official job was really working for my uncle's metal fabrication shop, and I got to clean the toilets. Man, they were dirty toilets there. And everything else was dirty in that metal fabrication shop. I went to church every Sunday as a 12-year-old, because my parents went to church, and if you lived in the Pollitz household, that's what you did. And as a part of confirmation, I'd go to catechism classes. We had like 40, 50-some kids in our catechism class back in 1968. I played some Pony League baseball, which got me out of being a part of the swim team in the summertime. No offense to those of you who love swimming. It wasn't my favorite thing to do. At the age of 12, anything memorable? I had occasion to think about that. The other thing I thought about was getting lost. You know, I can't remember as a 12-year-old ever getting lost. I can't remember as a 12-year-old ever being left behind by my parents, which is kind of a reassuring thing to know. I do know that as a 12-year-old, there were some pretty good hiding places that I knew about in our house. We also had a nice basement, too, a lot of places to hide in my dad's workbench area and whatnot. Although I will admit that since I've become an adult, I've gotten lost more times than I care to mention. Even with the wonders of a GPS, I can still manage to get lost. You can just ask my wife about that. She knows that. I've been out on walks in the middle of the woods and have gotten lost for hours. Not a fun thing. I do believe that pretty much for all four of our children, we've lost them a few times here and there. Sometimes we even went to look for them after we lost them, but usually they just come back. Sometimes they're a little bit distressed, although one time when Joel got lost, he came back in the police car, and the police had given him all kinds of candy, so he was actually pretty happy about getting lost, and was looking forward to getting lost again another time. Do you find it a little bit odd? This story, this story of Jesus being in the temple, which isn't so odd there, talking to people, nothing odd about that. But the fact that there's a story of Jesus as a 12-year-old getting lost or left behind by his parents. I don't know, I find that a little bit unusual. Along with the fact that it only appears in the Gospel of Luke in the second chapter. Matthew, Mark, John either didn't know about it or had no interest in it. That for some reason or other, Luke includes this story, the only story that we have of Jesus as something other than an adult or an infant. We get this story of Jesus as a 12-year-old in the temple. I called kind of this little section both and, because as you look at the story, on the one hand, you see that it's a foreshadowing story. It's got some stuff that's going to unfold that makes you think back about Jesus as a 12-year-old in the temple. For example, in the Gospel of Luke, there's only two times where Jesus is in the temple or there for the Passover. His parents did it every year, apparently. It's one of the three major festivals that happen over the course of a year in those days. And people and families, they make a pilgrimage to Jerusalem and participate in this festival, this pilgrimage, where in this case it was a pilgrimage to celebrate the Passover, a week-long event that they were there for. And they're there to celebrate the Passover, but we know that there's going to be one more occasion, just one, in the Gospel of Luke, where Jesus celebrates the Passover. Not with his parents this time, but with his disciples. And they're gathered around the table, and wouldn't you know it, part of the topic of conversation is Jesus' suffering. They're in the temple, and as I said, you know, there's no other occasion where Jesus is in the temple except one other time after this, where he's in the temple and, here, there, Jesus is asking questions and listening to the teachers and all that sort of thing. And they're amazed. That's what we read. They're amazed at his understanding and his questions. Well, the next time Jesus is going to be in the temple, he's going to be cleansing the temple. There's going to be a reaction as well to that, but it's not going to be so much about amazement, but they're going to look for a way to kill him. And then there's this piece in there about how it is that, well, Jesus was lost for 3 days. Can you imagine your kid being lost for 3 days? I can't imagine that. Not even 3 minutes, 3 seconds. Wouldn't want that to happen. But 3 days, Luke tells us that he was gone, lost for 3 days. Couldn't find him for 3 days. Next mention of 3 days has to do with 3 days that Jesus was gone, buried in a tomb, until he was raised from the dead. Of course, you might want to think about how it is that Mary, once again, in our story here, treasured these things in her heart. And that might remind you of the Christmas story, because there in the Christmas story, the shepherds, when they came and visited Mary and Joseph and the babe, after that, she pondered those things and treasured them in her hearts. And we didn't read this story last Sunday, but last Sunday, Jesus was brought as an infant for the dedication for the circumcision. And one of the people that held the baby, guy by the name of Simeon said this to Mary about how a day would come that would a sword would pierce your own heart, your own soul too. So this story of Jesus as a 12-year-old and what happened foreshadows some things in his own life later on. Very pointed things about what happened in the temple and the Passover and suffering and death and even being raised from the dead 3 days later. So you can almost see the reason why Luke would include this unique story, because it's leading us to some other things that are going to happen. But then I thought about, okay, so that's great. What about us? Is it foreshadowing anything for us, especially as we gather to worship this first Sunday in a new year? By the way, you know, if Christmas wouldn't have fallen where it would have fallen this year, and us being in the year of Luke, this story wouldn't have made it into the lectionary. It just so happened that it's here this year. You go 4 years before, wouldn't have happened. We would have been into the season of Epiphany. But here we have this story, the 12-year-old. And here we have ourselves moving out of a year that's been unlike any other year and trying to be hopeful as we move into a new one. I wonder if this story has got anything to say about that. Actually, I'm not wondering, because I do believe that it does. That maybe some things can be found in 2021. Some things can maybe even be found in us in 21, or things to be found. You know, this is a story about finding Jesus after 3 days as he's left behind, that he wasn't where they thought he was. He got found. That 2021 would be a year again that we would be found, forgive the redundancy, found. That we would find ourselves as ones who are found. Not that we're finding somebody, but that we know that someone has found us. That's a Christmas story. It's about a God who comes to this planet Earth as a babe in a manger to find people, to establish a relationship with people, to bring about faith in people. It's God's marvelous way of doing that, as opposed to some other sort of way. God became one of us so that we might be found. And that as much as anything in 2021, for you and I to be found, that we know that Christ has come into our lives, that we're found, we're in relationship with him. I don't know if you have any plans to go anywhere in 2021 yet, but you probably aren't going to go to the Holy Land in Israel, but this is a story about what happened in the temple, what happened in Jerusalem. This is the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. And I hope that in 21 you and I can always be found in Jerusalem. This is inside of the old city of Jerusalem. Back in Jesus' day, the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, that domed building, it's actually a massive building with all kinds of porticos. You could spend days inside of it. It used to be actually outside of the city of Jerusalem, but now a wall has come around it and it's included in it. But you go inside of the Church of the Holy Sepulchre in Jerusalem, and there's a place where historically they believe Jesus was crucified, in the same building. The place where they believe Jesus was crucified. And you go some distance, and it's a little bit of a trip, to the place where the Holy Sepulchre is, where they believe Jesus was buried and raised from the dead. It's all right there in this one now Church of the Holy Sepulchre in Jerusalem. And we would be found there. We'd be found at the place of the crucifixion and the resurrection. We'd be living it and knowing it and trusting in it every day. Of course, not just 2021, but for every day of our life. You know, one of the wonderful things about what 2020 did was it changed the way we do communion here. We all miss the Hawaiian bread. And maybe we don't care too much for those little bitty pieces of bread in those miniature chalices. But we decided as a result of that to share communion every week. There's a lot of the churches that have always done it every week. Maybe we're just slow getting to it. But we decided to do that in part, because of how it happens. But it's a good thing that we have, I believe, because we want to be found in that meal, found in the Passover meal, as Jesus gathered with his family to celebrate the Passover that first time and that last time. So that we are found in this meal of Holy Communion that we look forward to eating and drinking of the mercy and the grace, the love that Christ has for us, the forgiveness that he offers to us. We continually be found there in that meal. That in 2021, we would be found listening and asking questions about this word, about God's word, about anything. I don't know that you can read. If you are invited once again this year to join in and maybe biting off a piece that is a little bit more manageable of reading the New Testament over the course of 2021, I promise you that as you do, you'll be hearing from God as God's word speaks into your life. And I've been doing it for a long time. I still come away asking questions. But we would be found listening, found asking questions, that even as we are so truncated and worship with some here and some there and some here, that we would be found in our Father's, our Heavenly Father's house. However it is that we get it done in these continual days of a pandemic. But we would be found there. Did you find it a little bit startling to know that the mother and father of Jesus didn't understand their own 12-year-old? They didn't get it. They would be found learning about Jesus for the balance of their lives. We don't know when Joseph died. Mary was was there through and beyond the resurrection. That we would be found understanding some more things about who Jesus is. Again, I got a great recommendation for how you can do that as we read the New Testament. Found learning. That we would be found in this year treasuring some things in our hearts. That there would be some things that are occupying a deep and abiding place inside of us. Words and promises, hopeful assurances. We go through this year like Mary did, treasuring things in her heart. That we would be found increasing. You know, there's a lot of things we want to increase in. That seems to be a good direction, unless it's weight, you know. Always trying to lower that. At least I am. But to increase in this year in wisdom. To grow. In knowing what is God's will. Who is Jesus and how did he walk and how I might follow. You who are disinclined generally to make New Year's resolutions, to be found there in this new year. And finally, to be found in maybe what is most important, I don't know, but to be found in that word favor there, it's the word grace. Charis, gifts, unconditional love. I invite you to see it differently. That you and I would use this year just as a maybe new or continuing point to increase in, first of all, divine grace, favor, unconditional love. To know more deeply and profoundly how much we are loved. The extent to which God went to demonstrate that love for us. That unconditional love. The love that knows every piece of information that can be known about us, and then this God who still would love us. That we would increase in that. Because you know, and I know, that we have those days where, you know, we just don't get it done real well. Could be on the job, could be with the people that we love, family members, neighbors, attitudes towards whatever. But that we would increase in that divine grace, God's grace found in Jesus. That would get bigger and bigger, captivating us more and more, overwhelming anything else that might go on in our life. But then also we would be found increasing in human favor and grace. In this fractured world that we live in, with the animosity that still exists and the fighting and the bitterness and the positions of this, that, and the other thing, that we would increase and bring to this world an increase in human grace, human favor, human unconditional love to one another. We are in desperate need of that as we face 2021. Let it be a year where we spend some time with Jesus as a 12-year-old who got lost but was found. And that we might even consider our own 2021 as a year for some new things to be found. may the peace of God, which passes all human understanding, may that peace keep our hearts and lives, everything about us in Christ Jesus, now and forever. Amen. You're invited to stand if you're able. Join with me in our statement of faith today. We believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of the heavens and the earth. We believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, come down to earth to be born of a virgin and live among us as one of us. He remained without sin, yet he became sin for us when he died on the cross at Calvary. He was buried, but on the third day he rose from the dead and ascended to heaven, where he now lives and rules with the Father on high. We believe that he will come again to judge all the living and the dead, and we wait with great anticipation for that day when he will call us home to live with him forever. We believe in the Holy Spirit, his promise to us of a comforter and guide. He is the power of God at work in us and the whole Christian church on earth. From the heavens to the earth, from the earth to the cross, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, you came, Lord Jesus, to fulfill it all. And we declare with all confidence, we believe in you and lift your name on high forever. As we begin this new year as well, we thank all those who continue to be faithful in their stewardship with new creation. Let's pray now for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their many and various needs today. Lord, may it be so that every soul gathered in this place, sitting in the parking lot, listening online, would know that they are found by you. That they would be found, and because of what you've come to do and accomplish, their lives would be made new. Each and every day, that there is some old passing away and some new coming. Lord, that we would always be found near the cross and the empty tomb. That we would be found by you in a meal of incredible grace. It would be found attentive to your word, how it is that we encounter it. That we would listen to you. That we would ask questions. That we would be found understanding you more. That we would be found increasing in the wisdom that you bring. We found, Lord, in your grace, that grace would increase in each of our hearts, and that we would be compelled to take that unconditional love and have it increase in our world and let it begin with each of us. Lord, you know the challenging transformative in each of our lives in some new and amazing ways. Lord, if we do venture to open up your word, we trust that that would be time well spent. That your Holy Spirit would be part of that exploration of your most holy word. And Lord, we gather as ones who have loved ones near and dear to us who are sick or hospitalized, who have tested positive, who have lost loved ones, for those who have endured accidents, who are battling cancer, who with a positive diagnosis of COVID-19 find themselves quarantined or hospitalized or even hanging on to life itself. Lord, there's not a lot of need out there in our world. We know as the one who comes as the great physician, as the one who utilizes the gifts and the minds of many therapies and hands and medications and treatments. We take these moments, Lord, to once again bring before you, before your throne, and trust to you the healing of those that we name now in our hearts. Hear our prayers. Be with families that are separated from one another, especially loved ones in long-term care facilities. For your church and all of its expressions, today we pray for Breakthrough Harvest, Pentecostal Church of God, and Pastor Jerry. Lord, for the varying ways that our lives are impacted by this pandemic. For those, Lord, for whom the struggle is with mental health, compounded by these days, but we pray for relief for those who do battle with depression and anxiety and chemical dependency. Lord, though there's been a break from school, the return is upon us, and we pray for all of our children as they make their way back to school in whatever form that it happens, and that you would watch over, guide all that unfolds, teachers, administration, and of course the students themselves and parents through it all. Help families that these holiday season has reminded them of not how close they are, but how separated they might be. Bring healing their guidance for lives that are struggling to find their way. Help and hope for those who are burdened with financial concerns, for our first responders, for those who are away from family, yet standing in harm's way. The armed forces watch and keep them. Lord, it's into your hands that we commend all for whom we pray. We trust in your mercy. We ask these things in the powerful name of Jesus, who taught disciples long ago to pray, and so we continue to pray together today. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Now may the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. And let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
We invite you to please stand. It should come as no surprise that as Jesus gathered with his family to celebrate the Passover in Jerusalem that first time, that the last time Jesus would be in Jerusalem to celebrate the Passover, he would be that close to suffering. We know it even in the simple first words that are expressed, that it is a meal that draws us close to Jesus' death, a meal of forgiveness. What he accomplished there. And with just these few words, you know, they begin like this. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." We share the bread. And again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup, it is the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." We share the cup. Please proceed. May the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you all always in his grace. Great to have you all. Just a few announcements to share with you. First is let you know that our annual meeting is going to be happening. We're going to make some accommodations for folks not being able to be here, maybe with some Zoom, but it'll be a Sunday, January 17th at 11 a.m. I am dedicating time every day to I don't say this to draw attention to me, but I'm going to be praying for every one of our congregation every day. I don't know how long. Maybe I'll just do it all year. But if you have some interest in joining with me, or at least even knowing who those folks are, we made up some simple laminated cards that have the names of everybody in the congregation. At this point in time, we're hopeful that it grows and all that. But just as a way to lift everyone up, I believe, and I know you do, in the power of prayer and how reassuring it is to know that there are other people praying for you, and how encouraging it is to just be connected with people by praying. So if you have some interest, we made some of those that are available on the table as you came in. Feel free to take them up, and I challenge you to take up the invitation to read the New Testament with me. Have some topics of conversation to listen and maybe ask some questions, and there's also a schedule for that out there as you came in as well. Our month for the food pantry is January, and the first, second, and fourth Monday and Tuesday we'll be serving in that regard. The number and needs are a little bit less than normally as they continue to do the drive-through with that. And also, with regard to that, if you have some food that you've been collecting over the Christmas season with the reverse Advent, you can bring any of that here, and we'll make sure that that gets the food pantry this month. So 2020 was a bit of a battle in many respects, a rough year, like none other. And what's 2021 got for us? I don't know. I'm pretty confident, though, that we'll be facing some more battles. But I pray that as we do, we live being found in the love that God has for us in Christ Jesus. Our closing song.
This is a song for the hurting. I hope that helps you to hear.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you all with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Stay safe, stay healthy, stay praying, stay believing, and may Christ be with you. And thanks for joining us.